who is globally acclaimed. I request Dr. Dean sir to introduce to the topic of today's webinar.
Thank you, Dr. Aditi. Respected Dr. Malik, today's expert speaker, renowned scientist of international repute, dear participants, outbreaks and pandemics of emerging and re-emerging zoonotic diseases, including COVID-19, have led to the unprecedented situations in the history of mankind, wherein global community of scientists, politicians, educators, and other
institutions
worked in with all their might to put in place their concerted efforts for preventing the disease spread, saving lives of people, and minimizing casualty on this account. In order to effectively deal with ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, leading international and national health agencies across the globe, public health specialists in infectious diseases, virologists and epidemiologists from medical, veterinary and wildlife disciplines, as well as other important stakeholders in interrelated streams, including politicians, administrators, army, police, municipal corporations, manufacturers of the medicaments and life support systems, protective clothing, pharmaceutical companies producing vaccine and drugs, as well as NGOs supporting Wheel of Life, have roped in joining hands with each other under One Health umbrella. On war footings, the frantic search has begun for saving lives and to have in place novel, rapid, specific, cost-effective, easy to perform, and scalable diagnostic tests, effective vaccines, state-of-the-art intervention technologies, as well as effective and safe therapeutic regimens to treat COVID-19 patients. The aim and scope of this expert talk and interaction to webinar is to highlight the concept and applications of One Health principles with emphasis on the threat of emerging and re-emerging zoonoses and role of various agencies, including veterinarians, to effectively deal with them in a team mode. With this, I invite our speaker to kindly give a elaborate talk to enlighten us. Thank you.
Today's expert speaker is Dr. Satyavir Singh Malik. He is principal scientist and he is heading the VPH department and steering the division for more than 10 years in 3 spells. Besides, he is serving as scientific secretary to the director of IVRI since 2010 at ICR IVRI. He also rendered his service as at many posts in the division of IVRI. During his past 32 years of committed research, teaching and extension services in BPH at IVRI, Dr. S.V.S. Malik remained engaged in research on masked, neglected, as well as emerging zoonotic and foodborne pathogens associated with reproductive disorders in human beings and animals, with special reference to development and evaluation of virulence markers and marker-based diagnostics for listeriosis, Q fever, and EAEC, that is enteroaggregative E. coli species. He successfully handled 20 institutional and DBT-funded research projects as PI and co-PI, among which he was a principal investigator for 10 projects, and he developed ICR-sponsored outreach program on zoonotic diseases in India. He has, to his credit, 83 research publications in renowned journals, out of which 52 are in international journals and 31 in national journals. And he has also submitted 9 data sheets to Center of Agriculture and Bioscience International UK and 58 GenBank sequence of zoonotic pathogens related to his own working domain. He also contributed in terms of 6 reviews, out of which he also contributed to 12 book chapters, out of which one is in international book and 11 national book, 100 lead and invited oral presentations made in conferences, seminars, symposia, and trainings at national and international level. Dr. Malik also took initiative in organizing FAO-WHO-sponsored trainings in antimicrobial resistance, national workshops, short-term trainings, which include 6 trainings, and winter schools and in frontal areas of VPH, that is Veterinary Public Health. Dr. Malik guided 24 students, out of which 13 students are PhD and 11 MBSC. And currently, he is guiding 3 students, 1 PhD and 2 MBSC, as major advisor in VPH department. He designed 5 new courses, restructured 4 courses, and developed several comprehensive digital capsules on zoonosis for teaching and training purpose, including 2 compendia for training programs, 4 units of chapters for online diploma courses run by IGNO, 4 extension bulletins, 13 folders, and 12 popular articles. Dr. Malik has been the recipient of over 60 awards and recognition at international and national level, out of which 2 are at international level and 13 are at national level, and 17 at institute and at college or university level. There are 23 awards. Best paper, poster awards, 6, including the prestigious FAO-WHO fellowship for the year 1999 at the University of Liverpool, UK. He was awarded Best Teacher Award at IVRI for the year 2000 and 2001, and Bharat Ratna Dr. C. Subramaniam ICR Award, National Award for Outstanding Teacher in Animal and Fisheries Sciences for the year 2011. He has been associated with editorial board, and he is editor and of international journals of comprehensive microbiology, immunology, and infectious disease from 1996 to 2010, and a member of Scientific Committee, International Society for Problem on Listeriosis, ISOPOL Meet 2013. Currently, he is the Vice President for the Society for Research on Listeriosis in India. So, we are having such a great eminent personality today with us, and he will be sharing his valuable knowledge with all the participants. Hope everyone will get benefited with this knowledge, with this bulk pool and tons of knowledge. Thank you, sir, and over to you, Dr. Malik.
Thank you, Dr. Aditi, for giving such a detailed appreciation of words. I should say I hardly deserve. I am humbled, and whatever has come to me in the lotus feet of God Almighty as His grace, there are several hands of my students and colleagues in making me what I am today. At the outset, I profusely thank Honorable Vice Chancellor of your university, Nanaji Deshmukh, Dr. S. P. Tiwari Sahab, esteemed Dean Dr. Baghel Sahab, and to you for having given me this opportunity. And I shall be elaborating upon this very important issue, which is of immense relevance with all of you, with whatever I could gain in this area during my working of about 32 years. So I would be making my presentations without. Is it visible, Dr. Aditi? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Aditi,
yes,
is it visible?
It is visible as well as audible, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Visible and audible.
At the outset, please give me 1 minute to pay my reverence in the lotus feet of God Almighty, the creator of this supreme universe. Om Shri Guru Sakshat Parbrahm Namo Namah. Om Shri Adi Shakti Namo Namah. Om Shri Pratham Pujya Shri Ganeshaya Namah. Om Shri Gurave Namah. Om Shri पंच महाभूतेश्वर नमो नमः। ओम श्री माता पिताभ्याम नमो नमः। वेल आई थैंक द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स फॉर हैविंग गिवन मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू डेलिबरेट ऑन दिस इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यू वन हेल्थ विच इज अ कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव सॉल्यूशन आई सी टू द इमर्जिंग एंड री इमर्जिंग ज़ूनोसिस especially on a befitting occasion of World Zoonosis Day. Yesterday it was, and today in the series I am here to present before you my views. We have got a lot many problems here to address, and which are actually we are plagued with in 21st century, with population explosion, infectious diseases, food security, poverty, starvation, pollution, and above all climate change. To add to our woes, recently a virus has struck and nobody knew that it can change the globe. And that's why whosoever has said that no person can't change the world, never ate an undercooked bat, especially in the wet market of China. Today, this is the morning statistics before you. India is precariously placed on the third place. Although we are doing well, but still the threat is lurking around, and it is the time bomb is clicking world over, with over 5,40,660 deaths, and out of which the 20,174 have occurred in the nation. Obviously, all the countries are closed, and 213 countries are affected. Such a magnitude of the problem that even the best ones are struggling to cope up with the situation. And long back, the plague eliminated nearly one third of the European population in the 14th century. And this is the data, which is only one very reliable, very difficult to arrive at, that zoonosis caused in low income group countries 10% of the total daily loss, that is disability adjusted life year losses. And in high-income group, it is hardly 0.02. So basically, the breadth of these zoonotic diseases goes to the lower-income countries. If we look at the composition of these pathogens, there are 1,415 human pathogens with this breakup before you on the screen. And out of these 1,415, 61%, that is 868, is to say, 6 out of 10 human diseases are zoonotic in nature. There are some views that it is an overestimation because somehow the Taylor 2001 have included some of the fungi that are saprozoonotic in nature in this list. But nevertheless, whole world agrees to this estimation. Zoonotic pathogens, who should be more alert is the basic question. Because 60% of existing human infections are zoonotic in nature, and mind it, 80% of these come from animals. So obviously it is our baby, the veterinarians. Because historically veterinarians have led the world in the understanding and identification of zoonotic diseases, because they are the first, be it the wild setting or domestic settings, to come across with these infections, and they report it first. More so in wildlife settings, 75% of emerging infectious diseases, not only they are zoonotic in nature, but 71% of them, they come from wildlife. So obviously those veterinarians serving in the domestic and wild settings, the onus lies on them. In order to equip ourselves, we must have the clinical curiosity whenever we come across with any disease which is new in nature and causing significant mortality in any species. ILRI 2012, they have screened the literature and data available with regard to 52 zoonotic diseases and prioritized the top 31, which caused 2.4 million cases of illness and 2.2 million deaths globally per year. Emergence of SARS, MERS, as well as presently the COVID pandemic of 2019 has dictated the terms to rethink and refocus on emerging zoonotic diseases, especially with One Health approach. In fact, we have to go for the realistic assessment of the magnitude, risk posed, and impact of emerging and re-emerging zoonoses, because it is a vital prerequisite for their prioritization, because we have got limited resources and successful management with limited resources at our disposal. Emerging infectious diseases, which are now coming increasingly, what are they actually? So either they have not occurred before, just like SARS in 2001 and COVID-19 in 2001 have surfaced, not before that. Or they have occurred previously but not affected great number. They have only affected small numbers of people in isolated places. But now they are rapidly increasing in incidence or geographical range. A classical example is Zika, which was discovered way back in 1947, but epidemic was recorded in 2015-16. Or these diseases might be occurring throughout the human history, but only recently they have surfaced out and recognized as a distinct disease due to infectious agent. For example, Lyme disease, which is spreading in many countries, was discovered way back in 1982. So emerging zoonosis, if to have a bird's eye view, 60% of existing human infectious diseases are zoonotic in nature, 75% of emerging infectious diseases of humans are zoonotic, they are emerging, 5 new human diseases appear every year, and 3 are of animal origin. And 80% of the agents, they are potent bioterrorist agents. So that's why this is an area which nobody can afford to neglect. Emerging zoonosis, the most important data which has come recently through Gavi organization on April 2, 2020, that since 1940, more than 300 emerging infectious diseases have been identified. And if you look at here, that out of 95 zoonotic viruses, principally wild animals serve as their reservoir and they are transmitted from them. Otherwise, some are found in both and some exclusively in the domestic animals. In all, 65% are uniquely derived from wild animals. So wild animals, they maintain these viruses in their own ecosystem, and they only come to us when we venture into their domain, or we bring them to our habitat in our settings. UNEP 2016 recognized global increase in zoonotic epidemics which are closely linked with the environmental changes, like as you see, every day we are facing it. Most important is this, that one new infection, human disease, infectious human disease is emerging every 4 months. This is really, really alarming. If we see the mass gatherings, there are actually so many people intermingling, and of them, a lot many are diseased. And that is how they are interchanging these pathogens. So approximately 80 million people attended this mega kumbh on 14 February 2013. How they developed actually, how they emerged out and why they are occurring so frequently, we must look into those factors. Initially, before 1970s, we initiated our life as hunters, and then slowly we started settling. Then fire, we learned how to lit the fire, and then we started colonization. And finally, what we see today is that we started living in colonies. But basic change in our habits came with the major industrial revolution. One came in the form of steam engine, and another came in the form of steel. Steel made the nations wealthy. What happened? We prepared so many things out of the steel, including the cages. And in those cages, actually, we have put our greed into. And that's why today we have reached to the state which today we call as an industrialized or intensive animal farming, where the animals are literally caged into these wired houses. And in fact, we are inflicting a lot of cruelty upon them. In fact, I would like to quote here Ruth Harrison, that if one person is unkind to an animal, it is considered to be cruelty. But where a lot of the people are unkind to the animals, especially in the nature of commerce, in the name of commerce, the cruelty is condemned. And once large sums of money are at stake, will be even defended to the last by otherwise so-called intelligent people. So that is a paradoxical situation we need to introspect. We must remember that pathogens do not respect species boundaries. Zoonosis even has walked into our bedrooms with the dogs and cats who never wash their anal areas. They are infected with lot many pathogens that you can see on left side, and leads to the diseases that are linked to those pathogens. And there are the ways sleeping with kissing and licking. So we need to educate the people about this silent danger they are in. And many of them, they are dying unknowingly and getting infected. If we look at the disease transmission concept, these diseases primarily are, they remain in the animals only, that is stage first. But with the so many wildlife, especially the bats and other animals and monkeys, this infection, when it is only in the animals, from wild to what we call as like monkeys, they remain in wild and in the domestic settings, it goes to the human. And third stage, which leads to limited outbreak. So here from animals, a few cycles in only human we see, but basically it remains in the monkeys. You take yellow fever, you take Ebola, Marburg, any infection which basically comes from the bat. And then a stage comes when not only it is maintained in the wild animals, but it is transmitted from human to human. So this is the stage which leads to long outbreaks. And sometimes they are exclusively adapted to the humans, like you see in case of pandemics of swine flu and presently the COVID. So this is really, really difficult to contain. So basically, we can divide the three settings. One is the essentially wild settings you can see here in the pink, and another in this light blue color of domestic animals. And the third one you see here is the human population. Basically, these pathogens are maintained in the wild cycle by these animals. But with the help of vectors or directly coming into the contact, or when these animals are venture into the wild domain in search of pastures, then they come in contact of these animals and vectors also transmit them. So infection spills over from wild setting to the animal settings. And then these pathogens are amplified in the animals, what we call as domestic animal amplification. So either through the domestic animals as well as from the wild settings, when they come into human and settle there, the organism adapts itself to the human beings and it amplifies in the human population. Then suddenly we see the surge in human cases, maybe in the form of outbreak or the pandemics. So zoonosis emergence has been linked to the agriculture intensification and environmental changes as we look out, especially the wildlife and livestock. And in that, agriculture intensification and or environmental changes are primarily responsible. They have driven the spread of these zoonotic pathogens in larger areas. And rate of future zoonotic disease emergence or emergence will be closely linked to the evolution of the agriculture and environment nexus. So that's why studies are needed on the complexity and interrelatedness of environmental, biological, economic and social dimensions of zoonotic pathogen emergence, which significantly limits our ability. Otherwise, we will not be in position to predict, prevent and respond to the zoonotic diseases emergence. So basically, as I have discussed here, that they are maintained in wild settings. From animal to human spillover comes, and finally the amplification occurs in the humans. And then finally, through especially the air route, ship route, trains and buses, this spreads to the global level. Nature and we, if we look at, share the same signature. And you see the tree stump, it has got, with the rings you can actually measure the age of a plant. And here also you can recognize a person like in the Aadhaar through your thumb impression. Here comes the majesty of God Almighty that no one matches one's fingerprint. But what happens? We not only share this, in one word, we not only share air, water, land, food, but we also share pathogens and toxins. And obviously when deforestation was done in different part of the world, it led to the malaria because they were bitten by the mosquitoes. Here also I would like to say that due to these changes, which are of ecological nature or man-made, pathogens are under transition. If you look at the success story, smallpox was eradicated in 1979 and confirmed in 1980. Guinea worm, the cases from 1986 that were 3.5 million have been reduced to only 51. This is a welcome sign in 2019. Yaws, but is still currently endemic. Although the goal was 2020 here, but 15 countries are currently endemic and 80,000 plus cases are suspected. Poliomyelitis, very old disease, but since 1988, the cases have reduced to 99%, but we are not able to eradicate it because of the virus is there in the Pakistan, Afghanistan and Nigeria. They are creating problems. And leprosy cases, which is again a social stigma, great magnitude. In 2018, still the 2 lakhs new cases have been identified. Neonatal tetanus, if you look at, 45 countries achieved maternal neonatal tetanus elimination, but still during 2018, 45 countries, but 14 yet to achieve. So that is the state of affairs actually. And here if you on left, if you see, so many diseases are emerging or re-emerging. And when in the storm of COVID, we have actually could not take care of other diseases. And that's why measles, which is coming in a big way and is spread in the fastest mode, then among all the pathogens, it has led to 1,40,000 deaths in 2018. So list is very long. My contention here is that in this Pandora box, there is no way to keep the lid on. But what you can't predict is what's going to come out, but you can definitely predict that there is something will. Why these pathogens emerges out because they go under mutation. And if you look out, especially the viruses and RNA viruses, so here the higher eukaryotes and bacteria, they mutate at a lesser rate. But RNA viruses, especially the single-stranded RNA viruses or double, they mutate at a very fast rate. If you look at this genome size here, and the mutation rate is much, much faster in this case, just behind the virions. So primarily, they are the etiological agents of 44%, almost half, if you can say, of the emerging diseases are linked to these RNA viruses. Most common class of pathogens behind new human diseases, because two or three novel viruses are being discovered, two or three every year, and higher probabilities to infect new host species with exceptionally shorter generations time. Rapid evolutionary rates due to frequent error-prone replication cycles takes place. As a result, the mutation is 6 times greater than those of their cellular hosts, 5 times of some of the DNA viruses, and that's why they are creating major problems. To add to our problem, migratory birds may be spreading superbugs, and researchers, they have warned, we know, they also die, especially because of the bird flu, and every country is facing every year this problem. And recently you have seen in 2019 November, just a couple of months back, 18,000 birds died due to Clostridium botulinum. So migratory and wild birds, nature have gifted them to travel very, very large number of kilometers. More than 50 million birds are there in the world which migrate depending upon the season change and food resources, and 5 billion birds of 187 species leave Europe and migrate to Africa. In the process, they may definitely convey certain pathogens. So this is the problem. What happens when these birds intermingle with each other from domestic and peridomestic or semi-domestic with the wild ones? So these viruses they carry, especially influenza and all these, especially influenza West Nile. So these are the viruses which intermingle and new resortants come. That's why no vaccine is effective in case of this. And if they go through mosquito bite to this pig, which serves as amplifying host, the number is exorbitantly high. So zoonotic infection with avian influenza virus and vaccine preparedness is a game of mix and match. These are certain examples of disease emergence in wild avian fauna. Just the list is before you. These are the viruses. These are the bacteria. Long list. And the fungi. And the parasites. You can look at and then you can appreciate that why so many birds they die. Now there are certain drivers of zoonotic diseases actually that are leading to the emergence of these new pathogens. And if you look at their breakup, the major, this blue ring goes to their land use changes 31%. Hello. नमस्कार डॉक्टर साहब, इसी में हूँ। श्योर, थैंक यू फॉर कॉलिंग, थैंक यू सो मच। सॉरी, एक्चुअली ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर वाज ऑन द फोन, ही वाज बिजी समवेयर एल्स, बट आई होप ही विल बी ज्वाइनिंग अस। So if you look at here, the land use changes are 31%. So obviously we have to rethink about our strategy. Otherwise, the second is the agriculture industry, 15%, intersector travel, 13%, medical industry, 11%. So these are the major drivers, because it's a major shift has come the way we had been doing our agriculture and house construction and all that, and the way we used to travel. And otherwise, these are having less climate and weather 6%, war and famine 7%, human demography and behavior 4%, others 4%, and breakdown of public health measures. Fortunately, on this front, the people are doing exceedingly well. But unless they address these vital issues, and there is no relief in sight. Similarly, in one slide, I have tried to show here that, for example, rabies are transmitted by vampire bats to cattle and humans. That has been linked to the forest activities in South America. In India, of course, it is being, fortunately, it is only the dogs. But even then, we are not in position to control them. Emergence of bat-associated virus, maybe Ebola, Hendra, all they are due to the loss of this bat habitat from deforestation, because trees are being cut and floods are uprooting the trees on which they abode. Early human cases of SARS were associated with contact with civet cats, and these civet cats are actually sold in the illegal wildlife trade, which is next to the narcotics trade in the world. And emergence of avian influenza, I have just talked about, especially when these birds come in the search of food near to the intensive poultry farming, the viruses, influenza viruses, are exchanged and they die because they are highly susceptible. And Ebola outbreak in West Africa was a result of forest losses leading to the closer contacts between wildlife, again through bat. It has spread to the human settlements, and Japanese encephalitis, a big problem in India, especially in China and India, was linked to the irrigation of rice production, where the mosquitoes breed and pigs serve as amplifying host. The Nipah virus was linked to the intensification in Malaysia and then in India. The link to the pig farming, especially in Malaysia, and the food bats, actually they nibble the fruits, and thereby those fruits are eaten by the pigs, and they come in contact with human beings, and that's why there are encephalitis cases in humans. Similarly, the Lyme disease, which was in the Americas, North America especially, is now spreading its wings in all the countries, including India. And here I would like to draw your attention that if a zoonotic pathogen settles in the kid, in the tick, they are transmitted through trans-ovarian route, and it is almost impossible to control or eradicate that disease, because with every batch of the eggs laid by the ticks, the pathogen is distributed to the newer areas and newer hosts. So basically, they are maintained in the wild cycle, in the wild settings, but if other species come into their contact, then there is a cross-species transmission, and either they are taken to the livestock or wild animals, they are taken to the wet markets that you frequently see in China videos, but these wet markets are common in other parts of the world also. And here, or they go to the domestic animals, and there they perpetuate. And finally, we look out for intermediate host, like, but every time we may not succeed, like in case of COVID-19. And finally, they find their place in human, and once they get adopted, so either the persons are hospitalized or it goes to the community for transmission. Initially, in this phase, if it is in the hospital, the nosocomial transmission takes place, and even healthcare workers are infected, as you are seeing today also. But here, this is the most dangerous place, what we call as hospital. Most of the AMR resistant pathogens, which have got antimicrobial resistance of alarming proportion, be it Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, Pseudomonas, Candida albicans, E. coli, they are the major source. Hospitals are the major source on the hospital waste. So please don't carry your children to hospitals whenever you go to pay a visit, and after coming to that, please wash your clothes, hands very carefully, because their limited choices are available, or sometimes no choices are available with us to treat the pathogen and the persons infected with these deadly pathogens. So more and more number of hospitalization of the people are increasing. And if the air travel and other modes of travel, they lead to the plus mass gathering. So air travel and other means of travel, they very at a very high speed, they transmit the pathogens. You can imagine here and see and appreciate that in 1922, around the world, if you want to travel, you had to take 80 days. But today the time has been reduced to just 8 hours in 2020. it is such a huge network of now today air travel that nobody can even think. But when we move along with us, we move, the pathogens, deadly pathogens, they also move in infected humans, animals, and livestock products, as well as most importantly, the vectors like rats, flies, mosquitoes, who get entry into these things, and sometimes they survive even despite of best sanitization processes. So big ones, who are the likely culprit if we look at the unsustainable urbanization, because the municipal corporations are plagued with corruption, mostly, and wildlife interactions, global trade, climate change, and emerging resistance. These are the major problems, and we must appreciate that we lived in a shared world. So, because of this, we share with animals 61% most common human infectious diseases, and what are not known to be shared are 39%. So they are resulting, you can count zero here, human cases every year. And otherwise, what is happening today, in nutshell, it has been said that intensification of agriculture, human activities causing increased opportunities, including the travel across the globe, and within 24 hours, we can fly around the world, and so as the pathogens. They are leading to massive economic losses that are preventable. If the care is taken at the entry point of travel agencies, by travel agencies, provided they are equipped with state-of-the-art diagnostic tests so that they may screen the population before they travel to the other part of the world. Here we can appreciate that increased population and urbanization on the part of man, intensified livestock production and ecosystem encroachment in the wildlife habitat, and destruction of the natural resources, they are actually leading to this kind of disaster. So we must have a biodiversity, because it acts as a cover to dilute the spread of zoonotic diseases. Otherwise, in a degraded ecosystem, the zoonotic transfer of zoonotic pathogen is very, very high. So if nature is affected, people are affected. People are now cutting out of green the trees. Rather, very few of us, we plant the tree. We are, many are engaged in legal or poorly regulated wildlife trade. There is intensification, be it in the name of integrated farming or anything. Intensification of agriculture without appreciating the fact that it will lead to the emergence of zoonotic pathogens. And climate change, obviously, is the result of the greed and neglect on the part of the human, what we call as mankind. But how kind they are to the nature, that's a question and matter of introspection. And obviously, the nature takes revenge. And so many things, including the AMR, is coming in a big way. So emerging zoonosis, why it is important, biodiversity is important, we can see, as I have told, they can serve as a buffer. For example, by reducing the population density of arthropod vector pathogen, like zoophilic mosquitoes in case of J. So we can reduce their density by, for example, in rice field, they lay the eggs. So there we can, like in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, farmers are practicing that they are leaving the fishes in the paddy farms. And Gambusia especially, they eat away the larvae. And at the same time, the income of the farmers, it is increased. And reducing encounter rates between vectors and reservoirs are, or among the reservoirs, for example, Lyme disease. So we are creating so many other species. So ticks will be diverted to them, not to the humans. And the phenomena by which high diversity reduces disease risk is called as dilution effect. So basically, I have tried to show here in this slide that if the nature is degraded, right, so there will be decreasing dilution effect and decreasing regulating services buffering zoonotic transfer. This serves as a buffer nature, but if it is degraded, the transmission of the zoonotic pathogens will be fast. So if it is unimpacted, the transfer will be very slow. So here it is the role of ecosystem, today what we refer to as eco-health, and that lies in the heart of the zoonosis control, because it provides the, we are venturing into their domain through bush meat market, wet markets, and that's why there is accelerated transmission and decreased availability of the water and other vital resources to maintain the sanitation. For example, water and everything is being exploited. So there is a compromised hygiene and compromised treatment. And obviously, the disease, they are keep on spreading. This is another paper in PNS which says that if the species diversity goes up, means diversity, they are in terms of, it is in the terms of diversity. So the host density is reduced because so many species are available. Contact rates between a particular host and pathogen and their vector is reduced. And pathogen transmissibility as a result is also reduced. That leads to decrease in the disease transmission and prevalence. Previous thought was this, that if we are having the rich biodiversity, what we call as commonly jungle, then it will amplify the disease risk. But the fact is just reverse. It creates a dilution effect. And as you see, suppose this is a vector, be it tick or mosquito or anything, so it will feed on some host. And those hosts find the shelter or survive on the trees. So if we are having more and more trees, more and more hosts will be available of different species. And these vectors will be finding many more hosts to feed on. So obviously, the infection will not spill over in human population. Here I have tried to explain the thing in this form, that if biodiversity is rich and all sort of species are available, this Lyme disease-causing pathogen, which is called as Borrelia burgdorferi, will find so many hosts to infect. But here, if nothing is there, only a couple of are left, so they will be infecting only them, and finally they will come to the human being. So we need to appreciate the bioecology of the whole health, and in that, trees, vegetation, and ecosystems play a major role. If the soil is healthy, soil, we used to worship this motherland. Still, we worship it because this is the yoga dhara. And now, in our earlier times, we used to do the organic farming. We used to use three types of manures, what we call as gobar ki khad, farmyard manure, another is the human compost, and third one is the green manure, the dhancha or barseem. As a result, humus was there, and on that humus, the earthworm used to feed. Lot of earthworms used to be there. So as a result, the plant was healthy. They were able to excrete the toxins and whatever, and their health was fantastic. Genes were healthy because the soil was healthy, which was supporting their life. But unfortunately, with so many chemicals, insecticides and pesticides came into play, especially in the greed of growing more and more by compromising with then Mother Nature. And that's why the soil health has degraded. Weather has gone away. Irrigation has either flooding or famine. And too much temperature, drought and floods, which have become a common phenomenon today. As a result, plants are under stress. And the microbial toxins, they are actually accumulated. They are infested also. The toxins are there, the carriers of the disease are there, and the diseased pool of genes is actually going through them. So obviously, the plant health is compromised. Even some of the pathogens, they are transmitted to the animals, we call as phytonosis, which is increasing area of interest. But here, if you look at the environmental pollution, pesticide, and heavy metal poisoning and altered gene actions, they are the major culprit which is affecting the human health. And zoonosis is one of them. Especially, people just are self-centered. They don't care about environment. Like people take away their pets and allow them to defecate in open. They don't even allow the dogs to cover these their feces with their hind legs. They try to. They will just drag in. As a result, Toxocara, Toxoplasma, these are the pathogens which are frequently found roundworms in their intestine. And ultimately, it goes to the soil, and in that soil, our children play, and their hands get contaminated. And basically, these infections go and kill them. And that's why these zoonoses are very, very common, especially when we have now attached bathroom culture. So we are more attached to the pathogens rather than keeping the filth away. So animals, again, livestock or wild, between them the pathogens circulate and the new and new pathogens emerges out in the form of emerging infectious diseases. So contribution of predator and scavengers, we only blame them that they have attacked, but the fact is something different. Leopard consumes nearly 1,000 feral dogs per year, reducing injury rates and potentially saving approximately 90 human lives. Old world vultures, gyps. The vulture decline are linked to the increased feral dogs that cause rabies. Because these vultures eat away the waste, and especially the anthrax has surged because they have declined. Nature has given us these wonderful scavenging animals which clean up the mess created by us. And bats, they may eat as many as 600 small insects per hour. And mind-boggling if you calculate 500,000, that is 5 lakhs per day. No one can imagine. Otherwise, we could have been plagued by the insects all over. Owls, again, they consume 99% of the crop pests and reduce rodent density by 33% in alfalfa fields. What a natural control of the rats. So joining hands with the snakes, they are the ones who are saving it from the predation of rodents on our food. And amphibians larvae, because we are using extensively the chemicals in the water, so amphibians are actually losing their habitat and their life is threatened. They feed aggressively on dengue mosquito, yellow fever, Japanese encephalitis, West Nile fever, chikungunya, malaria. So if we are able to control the mosquito in a natural way, I think that we can control at least 8 major zoonotic diseases, Japanese encephalitis. Spotted hyena, which is again killed by human, just if they see, nearly 90% studied hyenas were located at waste dumps because they clear it. So Indian biodiversity, we need to appreciate the role of the nature even under one hand segment which is highly neglected. We talk and think of only medical, veterinary and wildlife specialists and their contribution. So Indian biodiversity, we are lost. Because of fire, 4.3% biodiversity is lost in 2000, and around 1,200 crores are lost per year due to the forest fire. So we need to develop the sustainable communities actually in order to preserve the biodiversity. 5 massive mass extinction with this much loss of the species are projected on the screen. So already 5 have taken in different type of on time scale. But what is important, we are amongst the 6th mass extinction, and if you see, the highest threatened are mammals and birds, and then comes the vertebrates, and then comes the other vertebrates. So just at a glimpse, you can see here, among the mammals, 25% and birds, 13%, they are threatened for extinction, and amphibians, such a huge, almost half, they are threatened. And here also it shows a picture that reptiles 29%, fishes 23%, especially this category is highly, highly threatened compared to others. Of course, they are flowering plants, mollusks, crustaceans, others, insects and arachnids. So already we have lost 543 species since 1900, but it is alarming that 515 species will be joining this list to cross 1,000 mark. What is speed? It is really, really beyond even wildest imagination. 10,000, 100 times faster than what occurs naturally. Every year over the last century, we lost the same number of species, typically lost in 100 years. So obviously, this is the very, very alarming situation, probably point of no return we have reached at. It is humbling on our part to remember that all started when one person got infected by one wild entity. Now, this is the scenario. We are living under threat basically even people out of their wild imagination started killing rats, the basic question comes, to kill or not to kill. So here, bats are wonderful animals actually, which support the nature. I have already talked about 400 plus species are around the world. Were only flying mammals they are, and they can eat anything, insects, fruit, nectar, even some eat fish, frogs, birds. Unusual long lifespan they have described for their small size. They have echolocation, wonderful system which led to the creation of radar. They go into hibernation and they form some of the largest gathering of the mammals on the planet, like Breckenridge, you can see on left side. And most importantly, they have got a unique immune system because of their evolution for flight. They are amongst all the creations I today known, they are the one who have got 24 hours on immune system. And people are thinking, scientists are thinking, a day may come when this gene, which is responsible for their always on immunity, can be transferred to the human. And we can dispense away with the vaccination we require for different diseases, because once the immunity is always in on mode, we'll be protected against any pathogen, be it mutated or natural whatsoever. But bats, despite being housed to more than 300 viruses, they themselves are never infected because of this rare phenomena which God has given to them, nature has gifted to them. Even then, 90% of the threatened species, a total of 170, they are really threatened. And really, really, they are great savers. Bat eat more than 70% of their weight in insects each night, 70% of their weight. Some pregnant female at 100% of their body weight. Nobody can even think. A single little brown bat can eat up to 1,000 mosquito-sized insects in single hour. And they are the reason that one third of the world food reaches to us, because 87 of the 113 leading food crops depend for pollination on them only. Because when they eat or reach the plant in search of insects, then they help in the pollination. And this ecosystem service is worth over $200 billion each year. I think nobody is contributing, even nations joining hands together even. Similarly, there is a great predator on this planet is called as rats, and many are maybe aware, may not be, but I would like to have your attention that they live in socially complex colonies. Greater than 150 animals share food, play with each other, recognize other individuals and communicate. But what is more important, they eat away the food which can feed the 2 crore people. They reproduce massively. And fortunately for us, God is so kind that 90% are short-lived and die each year due to direct competition and predation. 2 mice can give birth to inimaginable number of 31,000 descendants per year. Means 1 million offspring in just 1.5 years. Their gestation is only 19 days. They give birth to 6 young ones. Again, they are ready for mating in 2 days, just 2 days. And such a prolific breeder, 6 to 10 liters per year means 6 offspring into 10 liters per year, ready to mate 600 in 2 months, they are offspring, and also mate after 2 months, thereby leading to 31,000 mice per year and 1 million mice per 18 months. They are the carrier, according to the recent paper, of 53 infectious diseases with all genetic potential. They are, the list is here just before you, viral, rickettsial, bacterial, parasitic diseases. And it is not that man cannot contribute to this. Actually, man has shown exemplary, this. I would like to share this success story of rat elimination on Georgia Islands, which are more than 500. And actually the mission rat elimination started on this British one, South Georgia Islands, which are 500 plus. Before 18th century, it was actually pacifism. There was no invasion of brown rats who came by ship along with man, and then they have eaten everything on these islands. And as rats are responsible for 40 to 60% of extinction of sea birds, they are so important for sea, especially seagulls, reptiles, etc., and reptiles. So Team Rat, including the best epidemiologists, toxicologists, experts in public health and eco health, they joined their hands and took 5 years to complete this mission, in which the 8 countries here named, they participated to kill them. They used Brodyfacom, which is the deadly pathogen, and they laced the bait with this pathogen, and that is lethal to rats once consumed, only once. It's a slow acting which confuses the rat about itself as a cause of death. Otherwise, they are very intelligent. They may never pick up the bait. And so precise they were. They have studied before putting the bait actually that how best we can put the bait that only the rats take and not any other target species like birds or vultures or anything. So only 422 birds, including 46 eagles, 320 loose-winged gulls, they died. And then no reappearance of the rat was seen on 500 islands. For 2 more years, they watched to declare it pest-free. And then only the happy sign, the South Georgia pitpit, which lives there only, it was spotted there in 2015. This is the first success story of human intervention in saving a species from a predator supported by global warming, because that predator started breeding more and more rats due to high global warming, this global warming. India has been identified as a hot spot because of the huge population. We are a hugely inhabited nation and we live in close contact of animals, sometimes by compulsion or otherwise, in order to see that we are comfortable. And there is a loss of wild sanctuary, biodiversity, dense human population. Interaction of human and wildlife is increasing because land is the most scarce resource. And of course, to add to our house, the urge to have our own house. Hardly I have seen people living in their ancestral house, but every Indian couple must have their own house. And building a house obviously needs the wood. And there is a great deforestation and land use change in the forested areas. So that is, these are some of the facts we need to appreciate. INRI report, out of 52, they have prioritized these 13 zoonoses, zoonotic TB, lepto, gastrointestinal zoonosis, cysticercosis, leishmaniasis, trypanosomiasis, toxoplasmosis, hepatitis, rabies, Q fever, and borrelia. Brucellosis. These are the 13 they have ranked. So what are emerging, re-emerging? I have already told re-emerging, which has actually, whose prevalence has come to down, very down, almost sometimes zero reporting, but again it has gone like GFT. Again, sky rocket high. So endemic, these are the diseases, TB, brucellosis, rabies, anthrax, cysticercosis, JE and leptospirosis. Re-emerging is JE, plague, leptospirosis, scrub typhus. It is coming in a big way. Chikungunya in southern part, especially in KFD in Karnataka. So they are emerging. These are why. What are emerging is avian influenza, swine influenza, CCHF, the earlier cases, Nipah, and recently COVID. But most important, there are several masked or neglected geniuses which are there in the society. But since they are difficult to work upon and to identify, because they are highly infectious and difficult to work upon, because they cannot be cultured, many of them, and require highly sophisticated equipment. People prefer not to work on, like bovine TB, Q fever, chlamydiosis, bartonellosis, listeriosis, Rift Valley fever, toxoplasmosis, and many more mycotic, parasitic, viral, and infectious diseases. So coming to the important emerging zoonoses of 21st century, here you all are aware of the SARS. These are the case details. It has spread to 30 countries in 7 to 8 months. And the pandemic was seeded from a single person on a single day, on a single floor of Hong Kong hotel. And mind it, as guests departed, the virus spread to the 5 countries within 24 hours. So that's why we need to have state-of-art diagnostics at the checkpoints from where we take the travel to different countries. I think this is the most important thing. So this is the pandemics of influenza. Several strains have caused havoc, including 1981 Spanish influenza pandemic. And then so many have come on this, and which have led to again in 2009 pandemic. This is swine flu. And that is how they are recorded, new avian influenza, and many more are coming every year and causing the outbreaks and sometimes pandemics. Middle East respiratory syndrome, basically in the Gulf countries, from Ebola and from bats it comes to the camel, and from camel it comes to the human. It is infected one, so it is spreading. So whenever there is a huge gathering like in Hajj, every year it is feared that this infection is spreading from here to different parts of the world, because this chain is established. Zika virus, again, as I have told you, it causes a great birth defects in the pregnant females, and it has gone into silence. So obviously during that period, earlier period when it was detected way back in the 60s, so it might have caused so many birth defects in the people, but only in 2016 it was basically reported as an outbreak. Major Ebola outbreaks have been occurring in the different parts of Africa. You are well aware, the total infection, sometimes less, sometimes more. And 2014 Ebola outbreak, that was the worst Ebola outbreak, killing 4,555 out of around 10,000 new cases. So this was caused by Zaire strain of the virus, and then so many other neighboring states and countries were actually involved. It also struck in the India, and that's why it was investigated. This is the zero in site where the bat harboring the Ebola was zoomed in. And situation reports, they have said this much cases Ebola have been reported in Guinea, you can see there. But in India, we were successful to contain the virus very quickly. And this is the fruit bat which was involved in this. Similarly, the Nipah virus. Nipah virus is again, it struck in Malaysia. But here, if you can say, they share Malaysia shares with other areas reported in the other part of the world, including India, because India has got a porous border, and this is especially Assam, Siliguri. This is a hub of business activity. So, the person come and they bring the infection to this. Otherwise, in Malaysia, outbreak fruit bat, they were nibbling it, and obviously, it has fruits have been eaten by the pigs. And even the sap, sometimes the bats that were located here, they have directly urinated when the farmers were collecting the sap from the tree. So they got contaminated, and through the infected pigs or through this contaminated sap, the infection reached to the human, and ultimately they died. So this is the kind of sap they drink, and this is how actually it got contaminated. They prepared it from these contaminated foods also. So that was the major problem. So habitat destruction, long distance animal transport, and intensive animal agriculture was the major cause of spread. So in India, in Siliguri 2001, actually it was important commercial center, and Nadia district in 2007, it has been reported. So these are the conditions, this is the center where it was struck. Likewise, KFD. In fact, in the Gulf, in 1992 in Saudi Arabia, a closely related virus, Al-Humara, was actually identified in butchers who handled sheep imported from Saudi Arabia. And then it was detected in ticks removed from imported sheep, but the country of their origin has not been identified. But an outbreak of KFD virus was reported in 2011-12, which affected 80 villages across Shimoga district of Karnataka, where it is endemic. Here, most important point that it is an emerging zoonosis, because initially the virus was just located within the few square miles of Sagar Sora Taluk, and within few months it has spread to greater than 2,000 square miles because of the deforestation. And the animals moved from jungle to the near to, because they were not having something, pasture and everything left for their feeding. And along with them, the ticks which were feeding on those cattle and all, they also moved. And it is marked by the deaths of monkey. Whenever there is outbreak, that's why it's also called as monkey fever. The recent statistics on 17 April 2020, I have put in here that it has spread across 12 districts with 200 cases reported across Karnataka, with 16 children below 14 years which ventured into the jungle. So because increased demand for human and animal population has altered the ecosystem, that's the problem. And you can see even in Andaman Nicobar, very high in seropositivity observed in the human population, even in the such an isolated island. So what to think of the mainland? Similarly, dengue cases are 3 times up, it says. So obviously reporting is, these are grossly underreported. That is the another major problem in our country. Premium Congo hemorrhagic fever, it has emerged sporadically in Asia, but has claimed many lives, and now it is well established in India. There are reports from NIV Pune that it has spread to almost all states, because ticks, they are moving along with their reservoirs to different newer areas. And most cases occur in human and non with the livestock industry. It is transmitted to animals by ticks, especially by the Hyaloma genes. So emergence largely depends on the transportation of the livestock, like cattle, goats, on which they infected. And it has claimed the life of medical persons also. And the first case was reported in India 2001. Now this is the scenario I have just put in. This is 2015 map. You can see this is all right, complete. So no confusion. But even then, how many cases we are seeing it? It is the, I mean, people who pick up the sample and other nations. I was talking to, listening to esteemed professor Sinha Chakravarti. They were analyzing the AMR isolates from 97 countries because the collaboration is very open, very honest. But here it is not. Japanese encephalitis again an emerging menace in the country. And here you can see that basically the virus is harbored in these birds, wild birds, especially these idiots, babula and manna. And then the virus transmits to pig, which amplifies. And finally, from pig or directly from this, the infected mosquito bites. And that's why this lethal drone attacks causes the death. And this is the areas actually, even they are highly endemic for this. According to the WHO report 2000, if you see 13, actual number of JE cases are much higher than the reported. And 86% of the WHO reported JE cases during 2006-09 were from China and India. Recently, I have today collected this data. The actual number of JE cases in India could be around 15,000 to 20,000. And what is the reporting here? That's the difference. However, only 10% of the cases are being reported. 4 recent data indicate maximum cases are being reported because they are put, majority of the cases are put in AES. So acute encephalitis syndrome. I mean, that is nothing. That is just AES. So whatever is not there, dengue, anything, just put it in AES and then get away with this. So that is a kind of approach. Here we all, majority, not all, I will say, honest always. But majority of the people, they are habituated to this kind of reporting, forgetting that you cannot, no, it is not possible for anybody to suppress these zoonotic diseases. They make their presence felt with such a bang that people are just stunned. So these are the facts or farce I leave up to you to decide. Likewise, trypanosomiasis in the Indian subcontinent, again, this is an insect-borne disease. So total 9 cases have been reported, 8 from in India, TLSI, UNSI, and UGI, ODNCI. This is basically the rat trypanosoma has been in IVRI has been a collaborator with the New Delhi and NCDC in identification of these. So this is the 5 cases in India, and strictly host specific trypanosoma rat, but it has been reported from the human. Okay. So this is the tabanus, which is rats and rat fever. And likewise, cysticercosis and teniosis. I mean, this is again a big problem. Big problem, because the pork infected, it spreads cysticercosis. And in 2009, I got a chance to invite 4 persons from AIIMS when I conducted a national workshop on veterinary and medical perspective on zoonotic diseases, and invited all leading physicians over here in Bareilly. They said, sir, we don't have idea any about these diseases. We are, we just have very, very fake, I should say, very less idea about it. So once even physicians are not, they are not having clinical curiosity or exposure about these, the gravity of these diseases, how they can identify first, forget about treatment. And if at all they give the treatment, it is hardly, it matters anything. So in that, Dr. Country has come here on a neurocysticercosis, and he has told that he was seeing 70 MRIs daily which were infected with this neurocysticercosis or neurotoxoplasmosis, and both are leading to epilepsy in human beings. So people were just treating them epilepsy without knowing that they are infective cases, either because of neurocysticercosis or neurotoxoplasmosis. So Sujit Var here, and he gave a wonderful talk here. So that's how we come to know through interaction with the medical fraternity. Likewise, TB. TB, it is being reported that 25% of the world population is infected with mycobacterium tuberculosis. But what about the mycobacterium bovis? And prevalence of mycobacterium bovis, which is called as zoonotic TB, has been reported, estimated, I should say, 1.6 to 16% in cattle and 3 to 5% buffalo. And there is a myth that mycobacterium bovis is less virulent. In fact, the mycobacterium bovis is more virulent than mycobacterium tuberculosis, and it spreads in all the 4 directions, man to man, man to animal, animal to man, and back from man to animal. Whereas the mycobacterium tuberculosis, which principally affects the human beings, it goes into animals. Animals serve as the tender and host. I mean, it further does not spread from animal. And these are the two basic myths in the mindset of the medicals. And they only look out for mycobacterium tuberculosis, which has got hardly 4 to 6% week of incubation period, and use the egg-based medium or glycerol, which is inhibitory to the mycobacterium bovis. Mycobacterium bovis medium must not have glycerol and agio, otherwise it will never grow. And it requires longer incubation for minimum 6 to 8 weeks, for which the plates have to be preserved and seen. And now the molecular tools are available. People should initiate the work, especially the veterinarians, to show. Even in the annual TB report, there is no mention of mycobacterium bovis, and that is how these masked or silent infections keep on spreading. So this is something an issue, especially when we top, India tops the list of human TB cases in the world. 24 lakhs new cases. India recorded 24 lakhs TB cases, and over 80% are 80,000 deaths. So it has even, it has, TB is still a bigger killer than COVID in India. And this is the statement by Honorable Dr. Harshvardhan on June 25th, 2020, that COVID has killed around only 15,000 people in India in last 3.5 months, but TB has caused 20,000. If we go quarterwards. So this is what about, in fact, COVID will set fight against TB back at least five years back, because all the resources are diverted towards COVID-19. So obviously TB and other diseases, which are major killer in our country, have taken a back seat, unfortunately. And people are left just on their fate. So annual TB report records this much death, which is much lower than the WHO estimates of 4.4 lakh. So additional TB deaths have occurred, they are projected between 2000 this much. Following 3 months of COVID quarantine and a 10 months restoration of service, this has been predicted. And Q fever again, it's a Nature paper which has appeared in Nature, tough lessons from Dutch Q fever outbreak. This is the pathogen profile of Bernardi, which is a benchmark for ascertaining the efficacy of pasteurization. It is the hardiest organism, and it is the most contagious one, as per the ILRI report. It is spreads, it is a class 3 organism, just like Brucella. But Brucella does not spread by air. That spreads by contact or consuming raw milk, or by coming in contact of especially reproductive secretions. But here, or through semen, it spreads by ticks, mainly by aerosol route. Even if one animal is aborting in any setting, all the people, including veterinarians who are breathing in that area, will be infected. Fortunately, 70% people recover, but 30% which slips into the chronic form develop the endocarditis. And in this case, endocarditis is really, really, the case fatality rate may be as high as 65%. And please note here that infectious endocarditis takes 1.5 year treatment on doxycycline daily, 1.5 years. So you can imagine the gravity of this infection. And ignoring the world's call that you should not cull the animal, the Netherlands, which is the world's biggest votary, and they have decided to cull the 58,150 goats because there were notified more than 4,000 cases and it was spreading like a fire. So they decided that we will infected animals. And this is the losses predicted here. Way back in 2008, we have also shown here, and we have isolated it, pathogen from humans, especially ladies with spontaneous abortions, because there are no tests available at that point of time, and nobody does it. This is not included in the torch, which is usually done in a pregnancy, in these other tests which are performed. So here. The percentage was very high, 24.35%, if I remember, was the positivity of the ladies which aborted in the first trimester of the pregnancy, because there the abortion is inevitable. And we have also studied its occurrence in goats and humans in Chhattisgarh, Odisha, India, and also the seroprevalence and molecular detection of parvovirus on cattle and their human contacts in organized dairy farms. Likewise, anthrax. Anthrax is also emerging, especially in this West Bengal, Odisha, Tamil Nadu, in southern part. And this is the glimpses of it. But it is emergence has been linked to the vulture decline. This is the paper which I presented before the Standing Committee on Zoonosis way back in 2008, where because IVRI has done a pioneering work under the leadership of Dr. D. Sarup, HOD Medicine, who has recommended it, and Ministry of Environment has actually was convinced based on the scientific data that diclofenic sodium was the major cause of visceral gout leading to the death of vulture. Raptors used to be the 18% where raptors used to be the home of India. But what happened? 98% were wiped out thanks to this Baha'i group, Parsi group, who have supported this movement of vulture restoration. And we are able to see them because God has gifted them that once the anthrax carcass passes through them, probably it's a matter of research that what, because once the anthrax vegetative cell comes into the contact of spore, then only it will sporulate. They eat away the carcass, otherwise anthrax carcass is never open. And it is possible that this might have gone through the intestine in a form that it is somehow spreading the anthrax spread. Otherwise, the carcass is eaten away by feral dogs and the wild hyenas and all that. And they drag, and dogs, they drag away this virus to greater, newer areas and spread the bacillus anthracis to newer areas. And it survives in the soil from 80 to 120 years, and mind it, in the bone marrow of infected animals, the organism can live up to as long as 250 years. So one time, whenever the land is done for agriculture purposes or otherwise, the spores will come in the surface and will infect the animals and humans, obviously. So this is the anthrax outbreak in West Midrapur outbreak. This was investigated by Dr. P. Dandapat of IERI Kolkata, and you can see here the charts clearly. So these are these charts. Leptospirosis, if you see here, which is again after every flood and rainy season, this is a major killer in India, because the organism is excreted in the urine, and this urine comes into the water, and this pathogen comes in water, and once your skin is sodden, It cannot pass through intact skin, but once its skin is soldened, it becomes soft and pliable by remaining in the water. It becomes soft and then the leptospira moves through the skin without causing any itching, pain, inflammation. Nothing is there, and it is inside the system, and it causes initially the high fever and then the pink eye because of the hemorrhage in the eye, and finally it settles in the, before finally settling in the kidney, it goes to the liver, there it causes jaundice, and finally it settles in the kidney and it blocks it. Because leptospira are so abundant in the kidney that no filtration can take place, even despite the putting the patient on the dialysis. So ultimately, even if you give the drug, we are not in position to save the patient. And this is the typical picture. When people in hurry of reaching to their home, they walk through because the ways are clogged with water, and that is how they, where this is the place where the sanitation department and all, they should be made aware of this this threat, and every citizen should take up the call to see that water is not logged during the rainy season, but it is a common sight in India, unfortunately. So these are the risk factors actually, and it is spreading, especially the rodents. Likewise, the glanders in India, which is caused by Pseudomonas, now known as Burkholderia mellii, and its cases you can see here. They are now again, it is, you can say that after coming down again, it is re-emerging. This is the typical anthrax I was talking. This is the char. So you put any ointment, it is not going to heal. This is the dead tissue with raised periphery red. This is called a Charbon or Siberian ulcer characteristic, whosoever especially deals with the skin of the dead animal. And in especially West Bengal and this Odisha and other areas, Bihar, where very, you know, people who are in tribals and very socially poor economically, they whenever they notice that their animal is in moribund state, they just slaughter it. Before it dies, and they consume without knowing that this may be infected because of anthrax, and then the anthrax, Bacillus anthrax, grows there, sporulates, the organism grows, leading to massive hemorrhages in the intestine and intestinal ischia, and obviously the mortality rate is greater than 15% despite any medication in these cases. Similarly, Lyme disease is also, as I have told you, it causes crippling arthritis in the human beings, and it quite often confused with the chikungunya or other common, because whenever there is a joint pain, people don't think. They think either calcium is low or vitamin D is low. Nobody thinks that it may be Lyme disease, it may be chikungunya, it may be brucella, maybe so many pathogens that are associated with it. So actually, if you see, I want to only discuss one thing. It has got at the site of bite of tick, there is a bullseye appearance which keep on spreading. But mind it, only 20-30% of Lyme rashes have a bullseye appearance which keeps on increasing. But almost 70-80% are just uniformly red. Uniformly red, that's all. And most important, that black leg ticks which you are seeing here must be attached to you for 36 to 48 hours. Means at least 2 days are needed to transmit Lyme disease. If you remove the ticks within 48 hours, you are not likely to get infected. So that is important to teach. And this, again I say, rarely itches or is painful. This is important, that this, where the site of bite is rarely, they don't itch. Lyme disease again emerging in India, you can see way back in 2007, this is the seropositivity in northern India, northeast India, by Borrelia burgdorferi. So how we can say that it is not there? It is spreading actually fast. In Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary, it has gained. I mean, many more cases are there. Likewise, the scrub typhus is coming in a big way, and at least 16 states are affected. 16 states, not a small number. The reason being here, lack of awareness, unavailability, high cost of diagnostic kits, and in fact, this is not a reportable illness. So what happened here? The Nagpur Veterinary College, under the able dynamic leadership of Dr. Sandeep Chaudhary, head of HOD, has done a marvelous work, and it was the head lines of the newspapers. They have given the diagnosis to medical fraternity and helped them to diagnose it. They have all the tests available with them, And based on the survey, they using the IgM ELISA, targeting 56 KDA gene, they have given the results that 22%, 83% were positive to this. And basically the rats, they carry these chiggers. So Thrombidium chiggers, which feed onto this. And that's why it is called as a scriptyphus. And they have analyzed in different settings and different seasons also, and have published their work in a reckoned journal. You can see here. Likewise, Chlamydial zoonosis, again, it is a neglected zoonosis. I mean, because it is difficult to work. So people not prefer not to work. As we know that Chlamydia cetacei, there is classically reported in the cetacean birds, what we call as parrot family. But now newer and new research findings have proved it, that Chlamydia cetacei, of course, is a house, is for this the major reservoir is parrots, but it is the pigeons, not the birds, not the poultry. Poultry, it is Chlamydia graminacea, which is a new species which has been diagnosed. And you can see here that Chlamydia cetacei can infect, of course, 450 birds, but mainly they are cetacean birds. That's why it is called as cetacosis, and can just lead to flu-like symptoms, headache and respiratory, but outcome is very, very dangerous. In birds, if infection occurs, it is called as ornithosis, where most of the birds remain asymptomatic and they pass the feces, which is yellow, and on exposure to sun, it becomes green because of the presence of the white sarks. So two new Chlamydia species have been detected recently. This is the paper, Chlamydia gallinacea in breeding birds. This is important, and you can see it has got a genetic potential, because it was for the first time it was detected in 2009 in domestic poultry in ponds, where it caused atypical pneumonia observed in three workers. So there is a possibility that it has got a genetic potential, and it is emerging fast in backyard poultry. You can see here, it may be as high as 63% of positivity or 81.2% positivity in China. And that's why, but Chlamydia cetacei, mainly they say pigeon and cetacean birds. So these are the five European countries, Argentina, China, Australia, they all have reported. And very recently in North America, 12.4% oropharyngeal samples have been reported of poultry to be positive for Chlamydia gallinacea. And avium, actually, it is primarily affects to the wild birds. Now, this is a new virus which most of you might have come by now, that G flu virus. It has got a pandemic strains of 2009 pandemic swine flu virus, and have got a three lineages, and that's why it is called as G4, 3 plus this 4. So suggesting that it might be able to adapt to human transmission, because it has got already a frame of H1N1, which is well adapted to the human. And antibody test showed that 4%, which is very high, of the total human surveyed had been exposed to G4. So this is a lot of swine population is positive, and they say that probably it may be, it is having the potential pandemic potential, which is a pandemic potential strain just like COVID. What is needed here? The teamwork, the One Health. That animal surveillance is needed, human surveillance indicated by this, and the behavioral assessment by the social scientists, that how the people are responding, how they are living, what kind of contact they are having, and laboratory team, which by doing the sampling, they confirm that it has come from wildlife human interface survey, they take up. And by doing the various kind of assays, and coupled with these surveys, output from the survey teams, they ultimately confirm that it is a pathogen and how best we can cope up. So coordination is the key. This is a classical example of the One Health approach. So what is One Health? Let us come to that issue. I just wanted to discuss this thing, because unless I discuss the eco health, there is no point in discussing the One Health. So basically the key word, the buzzword, is the collaboration. There are the four definitions given by the top agencies, One Health Commission, FAO, another is WOAH, what we call as OIE better, and One Health Initiative. All have got a buzzword, whether it is effort, collaborative, multiple health agencies or professions,
to attain optimal health, or a collaborative international cross-sectoral multi-pronged mechanism. It is mechanism they have used the word to address threat and reduce risks. Here it is a collaborative and all-encompassing way to address. This is the same thing. And the interdisciplinary collaboration and communication in all aspects of healthcare for human, animals, and environment. Mostly, this is a neglected. This is most neglected area. So what is One Health? If you look at all the historical perspective, it's a new phase. But the concept extends back to ancient times. That is new wine in old bottle. Hippocrates, in his text on airs, waters, and places, recognized that environmental factors can impact human health. And then came Rudolf Virchow, who coined the term zoonosis. He is the father of comparative medicine. And he said that between animal and human medicine, there is no dividing line, and nor should there be. The object is different, but the experience obtained constitutes the basis of all medicine. That we need to, this is a cross-disciplinary effort of Virchow. And the concept of one medicine was coined by Calvin W. Schaube, an authority in veterinary public health and medicine. And he has written a book in 1960, where he has coined the term one medicine, that there's no difference of paradigm between human and veterinary medicine. Both sciences share a common body of language and anatomy, physiology, pathology, and origin of diseases in our system. So on early record from 14th work in King Ashoka, the medical treatment for human and medical have actually been itched. And then came the legendary, the pioneer in rinderpest control, the Giovanna Maria Lessinsi, and John Hunter, again a pioneer worker in comparative medicine at Harvard Journal, named synonymous to the smallpox vaccination. They all talked about it. And they then many terms was given, which mean one. If you say one medicine, it means it talks about the mental shift. We see from one medicine to one health, to a broader perspective covering not only infectious disease, but the general public health issues, comparative medicine and coverage. So this is a broader term. And comparative medicine, the idea of comparing humans to one or more chosen animal species, or the other way around. For example, we study the atherosclerosis in rabbits or any animal model, and then see to them that what they may cause in the human settings. Translational medicine, this is most important, that unless we are translate the knowledge that we have arrived in the labs, the basic scientific understanding, into new and improved therapies, procedures, and diagnostic tools, it is of no use. This is something what we call as lab to land. And this is something where we find, the research finds its real meaning in saving the human and animal lives. Another is the zoo ambiguity, that is human and animal in many cases develop the same or similar health problems, or evolutionary medicine. That is to adopt biological ideas of micro and micro evolution, fitness and environmental to medical thinking. Everything has got one essence, that is one health. What is the benefits of one health? It improves the animal and human health by interdisciplinary collaboration. It meets new global challenges. It develops a new center of excellence for education and training in specific area. It increases professional opportunities and gains scientific knowledge to create innovative programs to improve health. So obviously, these are the areas, including zoonosis, and the food safety, security, global water, food system, training, creation of scientific knowledge and regulatory enforcement in the middle, and climate change, land use pattern, occupational health. They intercommunicate, they are interrelated with each other. And that is why we need to work in togetherness, in collaborative mode. This is the same reflection that everything revolves around the human health, animal health, and environmental health. So strategic outcome, what would be? The first priority, if we have to prioritize, should be that we must protect people from zoonotic disease. Second priority, protect food safety and security. Third, protect animal health and welfare. And protect trade is the fourth priority. So that is why we should prioritize our resources. And there are several opportunities for One Health partnership in health systems and programs implementation. As you see, different programs, IDSP, NRHN, then RDDL and CADRAD, the IVRI is working as a central agency here at CADRAD, and then we have got 8 RDDLs and newer institutions like Public Health Foundation, and one we have proposed long back as National Science for National Institute for Zoonosis, our National Institute for One Health. Now we hope it will come someday as a most important thing, because we don't have any institution to address 868 diseases. Now, how can we control? How can we coordinate existing intersectoral or coordination mechanisms? They are needed at different level. So, possible pathway for veterinarians that provide the health and well-being of animals used in research and testing, that is one. And another is comparative medicine research, the biology and disease in animal models, so that we improve the human and animal health. So veterinarians may serve as a scientist for translational research in basic and clinical and applied sciences. They are the one who address the veterinary questions, human health questions, under One Health and One Medicine. And they are the primary investigators and collaborative scientists. So, enhancing public health efficacy basically depends on the multidisciplinary collaboration, either of the experts and specialists in different stakeholders, physicians, veterinarians, nurses, microbiologists, engineers, sanitarians, dentists, estheticians, entomologists, ecologists. For example, in plague, entomologists, they will only identify the species of flea, and ecologists will tell. Likewise, the collaborations between different agencies for facilitating and advancing disease prevention and control, be it at local level, local-state interaction, state-to-state, state-national, and national to international, like OIEWHO. So these are the recent milestones which I have just written, and most of you are aware that how it has progressed from year 2000 to 2016 on International Health Day. It is observed every year on November 3. This is a major initiative taken in the larger interest of the global community. So One Health umbrella covers so many disciplines and basically falling under three systems: individual health, population health like VPH, or community health in human medicine, and ecosystem health. Here we address all the infectious agents, bacterial, viral, vector-borne, parasites, and also the issues related to antimicrobial resistance, bio threats, because and food safety. They are linked to the global health, and for that we use the tools of surveillance, vector control, vaccines and therapies and sanitation as interventions. At the same time, while addressing this infectious disease gamut, we also look out at the non-infectious diseases like joint and skeletal disease in human and animals, cancer, cardiovascular diseases, environmental hazards on account of exposure to human and animal health, like you see all heavy metal poisoning and all that, and metabolic disorders in humans and animals. And then only a concept that became an approach, and that became a movement. We must always remember pathogens do not respect species boundaries. I am again projecting this slide, but it is really a matter of introspection. Then why don't we move out of our cages, of our professional boundaries? Long back, with the help of my colleagues, we have made this thing way back in 2005 and 6 as agreement of performance to work to CRO, WHO. And we have developed this role model system for developing countries, including India, and we suggested APEX, National Authority for Disease Surveillance and Monitoring and Control, like for NDMA, like disaster management. This is a disaster, like any zoonotic pathogen of pandemic nature or outbreak nature is a disaster. And this we proposed by using the existing setup, like Ministry of Forest and Environment, from grassroots level to DFO to CLL to WII, FRI, and Chief Forest Conservator. To the Ministry of Health, right from medical officer at primary health center to district or CMO or commissioner and state, NICD, IDSP, DGS, ICMA. And then this is our setup, agriculture, Ministry of Agriculture, be it animal husbandry commissioner, carry institutions, NRCs, IBRI, RDDLs, commissionary level, labs, DDDLs, and this is basically field units. Unless they coordinate from this base level and report honestly. That is most important. Nothing can be done. And ultimately, they must be put, everybody should be made responsible under a authority. So a authority is needed to communicate. All these must communicate with a kind of institute of paramount importance, what we suggested as a National Institute of VPH or zoonosis, or now people say One Health. But it is a component of One Health, and so that this authority can effectively communicate with the international agencies. So chronology, if you see, of the One Health, which links the healthy environment, healthy animal and people, the publications were only 1832. In 1832, these were the publications which rose to 917, 1980. And now you can see the surge in the publication, because this is the way of living. 75,000. Why collaboration is needed? The best can be explained by the story of six blind men and the elephants, who interpret an elephant in their own way with limited understanding and having their ego in their mind and not joining the hands with other, not communicating, not coordinating. Obviously, trunk is just like a spear. This is just like he is thinking about whether it is a gnat or a snake, and this fellow is thinking the tail as rope. So likewise, unless we coordinate and cooperate, these sectors, as in most of the developing world, they are habit. They are in habit of working independently, in isolation, unfortunately. In the name of professional ego or their personal interest or selfishness, whatever you call. So this is the major limitation. For example, if we want to target the malaria, what can be the major a health team you would like to contract? A veterinarian, a physician, a nurse, a public health worker, epidemiologist, wildlife scientist, local leader, a politician, environmental health worker, ecologist, social scientist, economist, communication specialist, emergency responder, pharmacist, public affairs, and information technologist. Unless they all are there, we can't achieve the goal. And everyone of has got a very, very unique and important role. So rabies is a perfect example. I would like to share with you, physicians need to vaccinate and treat victims, veterinarians to vaccinate and sterilize dog and cat, wildlife experts to advise on oral vaccination, ecologists to tell responsible authorities why sterilization is better than culling, sanitarians to eliminate garbage that feeds stray, educators to teach people to vaccinate their pets, media to inform about risk, and more important, we should have the kennel clubs where the stray dogs can be put in and they can be taken care of, otherwise they bite. And that is how we are unable to come. What a shame that 20,000 deaths per year, such a painful death, and despite having such a huge infrastructure, we are failing because we are not coordinating, we are not serious actually, had it been. Otherwise, the dog transmitted rabies, I think, is the easiest to control compared to the fox or in wild setting. The wolves, like in Russia, in Belgium, like foxes, or vampire bats in North America, I mean, they are really, really difficult to control. Another example which I have put before that presentation in 2008 before the Standing Committee on Zoonosis, I would like to share with you that intersectoral, what the veterinary agencies need to do, mandatory notification by RDDL and on Kerala pattern. Late, very revered senior scientist, revered president of the nation, late Shri APJ Abdul Kalam Sahab, has given a model there. Zoonosis Control Committee, ZCC, Zoonosis Control Committee. He said that there must be at village level three persons, veterinarians, medicos, and wildlife experts. They need to communicate with each other and report to their individual agency so that they cannot suppress. For example, veterinarian does not report to their higher-ups, or medical person does not report about their zoonosis to higher-ups. Others will report. As a result, ultimately, we will come to know that there is a zoonotic disease, and the timely there will be control in place. Otherwise, most of them, they are suppressed and transferred and harassed for reporting a new disease. That is a harsh reality. Strict enforcement is needed. Surveillance and monitoring of animal anthrax cases should be done by concerned district, state, and central veterinary agencies through veterinary hospitals in village, block, district level, RDDL, SAUs, private veterinary practitioners, as well as NGOs. Then identify a zone and areas for enzootic anthrax, along with the reason for its spread and emergence. Clinical response in terms of efficacy and resistance to antibiotic in use, for example, because some resistant strains of anthrax are now being reported. So if we are treating with the classical antibiotics, I mean, even otherwise the patient will die. Isolation and identification of the characterization of the bacillus anthracis isolates from animals and animal byproducts, as well human contacts by specialized lab at a state level like RDDL, CDDL, or an ICD or NCDC, you call the VPS department at IVRI, and not only IVRI but SAUs. Continuing veterinary education, that is very, very important for field veterinarians, in order to educate them for not using diclofenac by bringing, of course, a law. But it is our own responsibility as an educated person, and use of the available alternative drugs like IVRI medicine department has suggested for treating the sick animals, with an ultimate to save the vultures as natural scavengers, as well as to update their knowledge about the drug resistance pattern in anthrax cases. Next was the identification of the research gap and vaccine candidates. Can we look out through nasal spray or anything? We have to work on developing a improvised vaccine with lesser side effects other than the sternest strain we use for anthrax vaccine, very old and having so many side effects, cannot be given to pregnant animals. Another is the initiation and support to research on clinical evaluation of vulture-friendly veterinary preparations that can be used in animals as safe alternatives to diclofenac. Again, public education on anthrax, this is most important through mass media, so that they join our endeavors in enzootic areas for ensuring their active participation or protection of animals from anthrax. How we'll do? By resorting to proper carcass disposal, site disinfection, animal vaccination, including the safety and response of vaccine use, protection of people from anthrax, especially in the enzootic area, especially those who are at high risk, such as leather industries, tannery, abattoir, where people are working, and people with poor socioeconomic background, as well as to motivate people to avoiding the use of diclofenac sodium in veterinary practitioners. Coming to the medical agencies, mandatory notification so that everybody knows that it is anthrax case, strict enforcement, surveillance and monitoring of human anthrax case. There we were doing the animal anthrax case. Same, using medical hospital, medical college, polyclinics, super specialty clinics, private practitioners, as well as NGOs. And primary health center even may report. Identification, so once they are reporting, so what if it is being hide? It is not being reported by veterinary sector or wildlife sector or vice versa. Identification of endemic zones or areas for anthrax, along with the reason for its spread, emergence and clinical response in terms of efficacy of the antibiotics, and isolation, identification and characterization of bacillus anthrax. This can be done in veterinary settings also by specialized labs, maybe like CDDL and NICD and CDC, medical microbiology departments in AIMS, medical colleges, and VPS departments. Again, continuing education for medicos, because unless they are updated, who is going to treat them? Who is going to diagnose it? And first of all, who is having a clinical curiosity? Identification of research gaps and vaccine candidate for newer and improved and safer vaccines, and protection of human beings from anthrax through mass education. For active participation in the for prevention and control of anthrax in animals, vaccination of people engaged in high risk occupation, proper carcass disposal, and this they should also be educated. And awareness about contracting anthrax by consumption of meat, milk from animals suffering from or died of anthrax. And then comes the role, very important role of wildlife protection agencies. Again, by mandatory notification, strict enforcement. And then surveillance and monitoring of animal anthrax cases in wildlife setting here, especially in enzootic areas, wherever it is prevalent, like in southern part it is more. Identification of selvatic foci, which is serving as a reservoir for anthrax in wildlife. Protection of vultures in the environment surrounding wildlife. And identification of a spillover of anthrax infection from wildlife to domestic animals or vice versa. why there are reasons and circumstances for it, they must have to come out. And preparation of an emergency disaster management plan for controlling any likely outbreak. And isolation identification of same, isolates, continuing veterinary education to wildlife experts in vets so that they are educated. And initiation and support to research for saving vultures, like joining hands with so many NGOs. There is one breeding center of for vultures in the Pinjore, Haryana. And release of more vultures as natural scavengers in environments surrounding the wildlife, and continuing education of staff engaged in protection of wildlife, especially the herbivores and vultures, so as to educate them that what is the important clinical signs of anthrax, their successful management. I mean, people in Canada and different world parts of the world, they have managed successfully the anthrax cases outbreak in the wild settings, and they have just using the helicopters, using the drones, using the collared animal, by collaring the animals, they have successfully, there are successful stories to contain the outbreak, which is much, much difficult than the domestic settings. And Ministry of Labor, here, people don't even think of. They should give their inputs for protection of people engaged in high risk groups, like mass awareness, availability of protective material, like protective face masks, gloves, gum boots, handling the carcass, leather, wool, their certification, whether they are free from anthrax, like bristles from a pig, natural, they are used for shaving brushes, mandatory vaccination, regular health checkups, and prompt treatment of suspected cases. And then comes the role of environmental protection agencies and NGOs. In order to extend their active support for surveillance or monitoring of cases, protection of fast declining vulture population, release of more vultures, and most importantly, the continuing education. Unless the social scientists, environmentalists, they join hands, and through mass media, there is no dedicated channel, unfortunately, in the nation about these 868 diseases to educate the people continuously by clicking onto those areas where one feels, for example, one has been bitten on rabies. There must be a channel where immediately people can go and find the immediate what is to be done in that case. I think that will go a long way. We are having so many channels. Fortunately, we have got a Kisan channel. But this kind of diseases, which I mean, spread like this, I have shown you this SARS. In 24 hours, it has spread to 5 countries. We need to have some dedicated channels. So there are 3 C. We must coordinate, we must communicate, and we must collaborate in real sense. Otherwise, we may be heading for the next pandemic of AMR. This is actually not less by any statistic than the COVID. And whole world is threatened because everything is interlinked. Hospitals, waste emanating from hospitals, nosocomial infections, which is infecting the people therein, sewage water supply, which is contaminated with this waste, and this contaminated water is again consumed by human beings, and it goes to the sewage, to the environment, where the pathogen survives, contaminates the soil, everything, and all that soil, the fodder is grown, and that fodder is eaten by livestock, and this pathogen comes into food chain, and this food chain again gets contaminated by so many vectors, including like house fly, and then again it contaminates, like you see so many things, street vended foods, juice of sugarcane, which is sold and it contaminated, it becomes a major source of food poisoning, and that is how we all are interlinked. If we are not especially disposing the waste which is coming out from different sources, so waste disposal here is very, very important, and being responsible. Otherwise, people are using colistin in food production, and it is leading to the microbial resistance, ignoring the fact that this is the last generation antibiotic, life savior for human being. And E. coli harboring MCR1 gene has been reported. And yesterday I was listening, I mean, so many nations, this pathogen has spread. Why? Because it is being transmitted from animals to human beings, and to the facts, and from both of them to the food chain it is coming, and pharmaceutical waste, they are also dumping their waste into the directly into the river without giving any treatment. As a result, these resistant pathogens are contaminating the whole environment and the fauna and the all creatures which live in the water, or they basically depend on the water or environment, like fishes, birds. And that is how we are really inviting the trouble. So we need to have to identify why we should focus, where are gaps. We don't have authentic data on zoonotic diseases, especially I'm talking about India, on more, so that we can prioritize which is endemic, which is emerging, which is re-emerging, which is really, so that we can move those resources. Rapid and reliable on-site diagnostic tool. Unless we don't have these kind of tools, our indigenous, which are cheap, easily available and reliable, how can we have a reliable data? The data itself is compromised. And then we develop a authentic data. This is a base for that. And then we have got a limited awareness about zoonotic diseases, surveillance and monitoring is the key, and intersectoral collaboration without which it is not possible. And lack of prevention and control measures. So it is not that India has not taken a lead, but leaps have to be taken rather than the leads. As you see, Satyajit Ray Faluda will soon detect COVID-19 in minutes, Kerala Institute of Sri Chitra, Tirunaldab, many more success stories. People are making masks and all that. And recently, a good news that Covaxin has been developed by Bharat Biotech. These are success stories. We also have made humble beginnings in this by proposing, and thankfully it has been approved by our council, and it is ongoing activity where 17 centers along with one collaborating unit team, we are coordinating and developing the baseline data, developing the very good reliable rapid diagnostics for diagnosing these infections in animal human setting. This is the IgG ELISA kit developed by IVRI. And this has been inaugurated on November 5, 2016. This is excellent, has got repeatability, sensitivity, and specificity, and it is cheaper than any available kit. And it is patented now, available. And this can detect actually IgG, that how old the infection is there in the swine, pig. Similarly, there was a need to felt that, let us see that whether pig is immediately infected, is recently has been infected. So, Dr. Kinnan Bilai-Gaukar, Himani, and her group has actually developed this test here. And this again has been with very good sensitivity and specificity. And moreover, here we don't handle the live JE virus. So they are very safe. It has been released in 2019, just a couple of months back, and in the presence of Honorable Minister and Honorable DG sir. And for hydrotoxicosis, again, an indirect ELISA kit has been developed by Dr. Vilas Ved from Bombay Veterinary College. This means, and we here at IVRI, our group have developed this. You can see here, IFAT, how much costly the kit, 1,53,000, just for analyzing 92 samples. A sample, per sample cost is this much. For ELISA, 510 rupees per sample. Real-time PCR, 343. And that, of course, it is not available, but we have taken the reference value for a step textbook. We are working on developing a rapid and reliable. In fact, we have developed and fine-tuning it. And this has got excellent results, sensitivity in terms of sensitivity and this is the test actually. Here you can see just like RBPT. These are synthetic peptide ways. So this, again, we don't handle the live pathogen. And it can be performed on site. For example, animal has aborted, just like brucella. If these tests are made available in the field settings for our veterinarian brothers and sisters, they can immediately diagnose the disease at there only, at site only, and can take up the treatment or control measures or prevention whatsoever is needed in that setting. That we need to. Everybody is working hard, and we have to work collectively. I would like to quote Dr. Sibelius, that vaccine for COVID-19 was natural habitat. For the virus was finally residing in the bats, in the deep of the jungle, but human has ventured into that. And the pandemic is a great example of how badly we have treated the nature. So to conclude my presentation, zoonotic and occupational hazards are preventable. They are very much preventable. We must stop indiscriminate use of antibiotics, especially purchasing them from the over-the-counters. And we must use the first line of antibiotics, and that too after doing the antibiotic sensitivity test as a responsible medical or veterinary practitioners. Otherwise, the AMR is not going to get away. And public education, motivation, and participation under one health approach. This is the essence. This is the heart of our approach. And biosecurity measures in poultry, animal, fish, and wildlife animal setting in backyard or commercial setting must be in place. These are ecological interventions. Best, they are needed to prevent and manage zoonotic. Here I come. What are they? So this is a recent paper which say that we have to live in the harmony with the nature. For example, if you want to control rabies, we must. So these are the three interventions. Means at three level we can block. We can block the transmission of disease. First, these are related to the host factors. Host factors. And then which is serve as a reservoir. And these are the host which is susceptible. And this is intermediate level. So intermediate host. So point is this, that if a pathogen is able to pass through and through among all these barriers, then obviously disease causation and spillover will take place. But if we even intervene at one level, best if we are able to intervene at all the levels. So basically in vampire, through vampire bites or through canines, the rabies virus circulates. So are we in position to reservoir, to reduce the reservoir density and distribution? How? By controlling the this dog population. So reservoir density and distribution. We should not allow the stray dogs to roam here, and then pathogen prevalence will also will be reduced. We should also vaccinate them. We should castrate them so that reservoir density is reduced. And infection intensity and pathogen shedding, if at all. For example, a dog has become rabid. So obviously, if we can intervene here, this is best. We vaccinate them, so there is no shedding. And pathogen survival and spread. If how, suppose somebody has, some animal has bitten to somebody and environment has become contaminated, that needs to be sanitized properly. Even all the care has to be taken that pathogen does not survive and spread to others. And spillover host exposure, if the susceptible host, maybe human, there is a spillover, then we have to see that we vaccinate them, especially on the labs and all the people who are catching the dogs and doing the isolation work and all that. They need to be vaccinated. They need to be protected. They need to be trained. And likewise in avian influenza, if these two birds, avian birds of wild nature, we do not allow them to come in the contact of our commercial poultry, then obviously there will not be any change, any interchange of the pathogens. And we can definitely control the avian influenza. Likewise, bats, they are the carrier of Hendra viruses, Ebola viruses, so on and so forth, Nipah. So if the virus is coming into the pig only, then only it will amplify, say the case of Nipah. So if we are not destroying the natural habitat of the these bats, they will be comfortably remaining there. Bats actually are being forced to come to the near to the animal habitat because we are destroying their natural habitat. If they don't find their, I would like to say here, for example, there was a flood in Bangladesh. So many trees were uprooted. So their natural habitat was lost. So they came to Assam. And there they had a fight with other bats who were already on there. So whenever they are under stress for food or for shelter, and especially and also in the mating season, the virus shedding in their guano starts. And that contaminates the whole pasture where the horses are there or our animals are there, and they graze on to them. And they also look out for other foods if they are easily available in the animal farms or in stud farms or anywhere on the pastures. So they fly over that and contaminate the pasture. And that is how it comes to the animals, and from animals it goes to the human. So basically, we have to take care that we are not disturbing them. We are not venturing into their domain. We must respect the sanctity of their habitat and their place. So likewise, I have talked about here also, Hendra and other Nipah virus. And likewise, if so many other species are there in the wild, which are available for carnivore and all that, like reindeer and all that. So many hosts will be available there. For example, ticks are there of Lyme, for which spread the Lyme disease. So why should they come to the domestic animals? They will be feeding there only and really will be living there. Again, I have talked about here that how to control this population of mosquitoes. I have talked about that there are ways. Now there is on pilot scale, there is a success that by doing the gene manipulation, the males, they have been made sterile. And when they went on mating with the females, ultimately there was no transmission of pathogen through the mosquitoes, which are genetically modified. And finally, their progeny ended. So once we are able to control, another I have told that by biological means, not using insecticide and pesticides and all out. No use of using all out. If the mosquito goes away from my house, they will be biting us outside. Will they take the license or permission to bite us again? That should I bite now you because you are out? So these are some of the things that we need to appreciate. And these are the slides. Here I would like to go, the last slide, that there is a genetic similarity between human and human to the level of 99%. 99.9%. We are so closely related in our DNA. But the basic question comes, how many of us think similarly? And most importantly, work practically. When it comes to are chalta hai, this is okay, this goes on, this happens, this is way of life. So many silly reasons come our way, and ultimately the goal is defeated. So when it comes to support each other as a team, I mean, most of the time I see in most of developing nations, the purpose is defeated. Maybe somebody gaining recognition at individual level, that is another thing. But ultimately, the larger goals in the animal kind, mankind, and nature, their interest, they are defeated. So we must respect each other and we talk. And I believe that it is possible to break the shell of ego, selfishness, and professionalism, competition, and rivalry as a brighter future awaits us. Just like a kid, come on to see a brighter future, but one has to observe and break the shell. With this, I once again profusely thank all the organizers, my esteemed colleagues who have joined for this, and my students, each one from the core of my heart, for having given me this opportunity. And I really urge upon everyone that we have got a long way to go. So we must take this message to social media, to mass media, to one and all, so that we live in a healthy world, in a safer world, where we are protected from zoonotic diseases, which can be best managed if we really work from the core of our heart, genuinely, honestly, as a team. Thank you very much. With this, if you are interested, I have about 10 slides to project about this is the condition of pandemic today, and this is similar to what 1980 pandemic, but here are some of the things about the mask. I want to share with something that droplet can travel a longer distance because of the force here. Otherwise, when we are talking, they fall within the 1.5 meter. But if you tough, they go as high as 2 meter. And soon, with 50 meter per second, this is the speed. 10 meter per second in tough and speed, 50 meter per second. It goes as long as high, 6 meters. Anatomy of our air pathways, if we understand, most of the ACE2 receptors are located in the pharyngeal region. So if you are not wearing any mask, all the infected particles from this person will go there and settle, and we will be infected. So what are we using surgical masks? they can only inhibit these larger molecules, what we call as droplets, but in fact the only aerosols, which are smaller than 10 micrometers, they can only be efficiently blocked by N95 filters, which are very costly, not available readily, and they must be CE certified and FDA and WHO and our own Department of Research, DRDO, must be approved. And for that, this is an interesting comparison here, that filtering effect, if you want inward protection, and this is outward protection when you are sneezing or coughing or talking. So if we compare the tea cloth made from home or surgical mask, or this is called FFP2 or N95 mask, which is equivalent to both, if you take the 100 as a reference value, which are produced in the environment, or here it is produced by coughing. If they are coming from the environment, and here it is going out through the coughing. So you can see here the maximum efficacy, that only one particle will reach us, and here only 30 will reach us. So please wear the mask under these precarious conditions, stay safe with your family, and major route of the entry here is the nasal path. And this is the slide which I would like to share, because this is CDC guidelines, that to successfully infect us, we need just 1,000 particles. When we breathe, 20 virus particles we produce. Speaking, 200 virus particles, and coughing, number goes as high as 200 million, and sneezing more than 200 million cases. That is virus particles. So many of them, they will be remaining in the poorly and air ventilated environments. So closed areas are very, very dangerous. Keeping this thing, although it is not as disastrous as measles spread faster, but it is quite fast. You see, this is the level of spread of the different pathogens, and this is their fatality rate they cause. Measles is the most fast spreading disease of chickenpox, and this is more deadly. This comes more deadly. But here measles has caused massive losses, massive losses. So if we see the risk scenario, we are at low risk. Even if we are within 6 feet of distance, or talking to someone face to face, or somebody passing, walking, or jogging, cycling, and well ventilated spaces, if you are keeping social distancing, you are at very, very low risk. And otherwise, if you go to the grocery shopping, the risk is medium, but it can be reduced by breathing time and power in high risk. And in low risk places, it is high risk. And workplace where, even with the children, in workplaces and schools and parties, weddings, business networking, conferences, we are at high risk. So this is all I wanted to discuss with you. Thank you very much once again for giving me this much time and having the patience in listening to me. Thank you very much. Over to Dr. Vasik.
Respected sir. It's always a great honor to hear to you, sir. Thank you for sharing such a wonderful knowledge. From all that you have covered this topic, I don't think so anyone has any question left with them unanswered, because you have covered everything so meticulously and in detail. And thank you for sharing all the knowledge about this particular topic of One Health. You have also covered the risk factors, the etiological agents, and also the lacuna which is there in controlling these zoonotic diseases, such as there is no collaboration between departments and between the subject matter specialists and all, and this has actually led to the spread of all the zoonotic diseases, and definitely a lack of reporting system that we have to address in near future to prevent such pandemics. Now, there are a few questions from the audience, sir. May I take them, sir?
Please take.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
One of the participants, yes sir, one of the participants has asked, most zoonotic infections are of wildlife origin. It seems like more species, more infections. But with loss of biodiversity, more infections are emerging. What is the evidence which makes it comprehensible how biodiversity is linked to zoonosis? Biodiversity, whether it is positive or negative factor in emergence of new zoonotic diseases? This is the question asked by one of the participants.
Yeah, I have tried to address. This is a concept that if the diseases are there in the wild settings, if they are there only and they are maintained nicely, wild animals, we actually, you see, the on one side, either we are venturing into the wildlife for recreational purposes or bringing the animals and selling and eating them and using their products for our use, and then only the viruses and parasites and bacteria are coming to our domain. So it is previously we used to work to respect the jungle, the forests. So if we are maintaining it there only, I have tried to explain the dilution effect of it. Previously people thought that it is the forest and wild animals which are posing a threat. No, they can't. They can't, because we are inviting the trouble to us. Otherwise, we should nicely maintain our veterinary sector, all the people, and but simply we have to protect them. Because whatever viruses are there in their natural habitat, they were earlier also, and they are today also. But once we are intermixing with them, and our animals are intermixing, we are giving more and more chance to have the mutated strains of viruses, bacteria, which are more resistant, which are more lethal, more virulent. And that's why the mortality is high and the spread is fast. I hope I am clear.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And that's what I said, sir. You have touched all the aspects. I mean, you haven't left any scope for the audience to ask questions. But still, as a formality, I'll be asking, because some of them have posted. Another question, the use of antibiotic as additive in feed of animal pose a risk to multi-drug antibiotic resistance as well as threat to human health. This also, before you have addressed, sir, but still, they have asked, I'm putting forth the question.
Actually, this is a very important issue when it comes to veterinarians. Now the CDC, WHO, everybody has clearly mandated that we must restrict, or rather don't use the antibiotic in feed. Previously it was used as a growth promoter. Yes. And that is the reason people have started using antibiotics of higher generations, in order to ensure that our animals or poultry especially, they don't die. And in this process, the lower doses were fed to the animals, the poultry, and that is how these viruses and the bacteria have emerged. And even where parasites are emerging now, which are resistant to the antibiotics. And that is a real problem in the veterinary sector. We can't treat.
Yes.
So we have to respect the global community, these standards and norms which have been made for our good. For our good. So that is most important.
Yes.
We must do the AST. People just, even medical and veterinary settings, people immediately want to treat the animals without going for AST and without giving the first or second line of antibiotic. There are clear-cut guidelines available on the net also. Yes. You may please browse through and can choose them.
And in one of your slides, you have clearly mentioned that the next pandemic is due to antibiotic resistance.
Yes.
Here, as you have mentioned, that tick resistance is also one of the problems. And here in our college, one of the PG students, he is working on some of the acaricides, the synthetic acaricides as well as the herbal acaricides. And to our surprise, we have noted that the ticks are resistant for synthetic acaricides for more than 400 part ppm. The amount which is written on the label, it is 25 parts per million. But the ticks are resistant, very highly resistant for those acaricides.
Another
very
question,
very
sir. Can a virus be mutated? Yes, sir. Can a virus be mutated and manipulated into more dangerous form? Of course, yes, sir.
Yeah. Very, very, very much possible. And in fact, many of the countries currently doing this work, although this is not desired in transparent scientific world, but many are in the process of developing the secretly, of course, the bioterrorist agent. I have projected that 80% of zoonotic pathogens are of bioterrorist nature. And time and again, you might have seen several stories. Of course, they are controversial. They may be having a content, and only time will tell whether they have a right or simply the allegations. But definitely, especially the viruses like WE, Western Nile, this Western equine encephalitis virus, this is having the highest lethality potential. Likewise, the you may recall the anthrax use in US to create a scar. Many have used secretly used along with the chemical warfare these biological agents to win over the wars, unfortunately. So this goes on in labs. Should not in the larger interest of the humanity. But unfortunately, yes, it is a reality.
Another question, Dr. Yogesh would be asking.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, I have a set of questions. Sir, you said that one disease is emerging in every 4 months, right, sir? So I want to ask you that where the disease they are occurring, and how can we predict, and how can we predict their occurrence in the and which area they are going to occur? That is my first question, sir.
Mm-hmm.
And another is, since the diseases they are occurring, and since we are veterinarians, we are dealing with the animals, and then how should we, are there any guidelines for veterinary hospitals to deal with this type of diseases which are coming there in the hospitals? What should be the model for veterinary hospitals? Is there any guideline for that?
Well,
notifying the disease.
First question I would like to answer. Because
yes, sir.
For gaining the benefits, or in the name of benefiting the rural population, especially those who are socially economically backward, we, or because of our convenience, we want the food markets near to our home, and we are advocating intermingling of different species which are home to different viruses, bacteria and parasites. In the process, we are the culprit. We are facilitating the exchange of these pathogens. We are making it so easy. That's why the viruses, bacteria, parasites, and even the AMR problem is emerging so fast, which is even beyond the wildest of imagination. So we must look critically into our recommendations when we go for this kind of thing. And you may be recalling that in our olden times, always the animal houses were kept at least 500 yards away from our houses, so that we don't sleep with them, we don't interact. Now the wet markets have been created where everything is available, everybody is roaming, everybody is purchasing and contributing also, because human pathogens are also going into another human beings. So we have basically compromised with these biosafety issues, and we have advocated in the name of anything that we want to support someone for livelihood, something wrong principles which we have to pay the price for. And second thing, always whenever any zoonotic pathogen we come across in veterinary settings, yes, you have very rightly pointed out, we must have a clinical curiosity, and more important, the courage to report that. Suppose you see somewhere that there is unusual death, or for example, you find of any species which is indicated, for example, crows dies or these peacocks dies, then we think of, okay, it may be some JE, maybe some West Nile fever, or maybe something. Immediately, if we are reporting, then people will be sampling them. It will be sent to specialized labs. Who will do it? Our brothers and sisters in veterinary settings. And you can, if we know very well the symptoms of those diseases, that we call as clinical competence. We can definitely say this we have not seen, this kind of mortality we have never seen. This is a new one. That's what the B.B. Komal has talked about, the clinical curiosity. We have to educate ourselves. We have to introspect that I don't know. Let me see. Look out the literature, look out, consult your colleagues, consult the experts in this area and coordinate with them. Very soon it can be worked out. And as such, whatever the standard guidelines for maintaining a biosecurity on farms, yes, they are available on net also. And any specialized organizations, which are maybe IVRI or all other SAUs, they are available. That what kind of biosecurity measures we should take on a new farm. Because we have to see that our own professionals are also not infected in ignorance. Like brucellosis, most of the people know. But how many know about Q fever? How many know about the other infections that they may pick up when treating the animals? That is my contention. I hope I was able to answer your questions.
Yes, sir. But are they reported? Just you told that means how can we know that disease has been immersed there? Means are they waterborne disease or just like we have IDSP like that all over the world, like the CDC in US, they are reporting like that. That is the data from, we can say, that one disease is emerging in 4 months.
Actually,
yes, sir.
Please go ahead.
Yes, sir.
My contention
is, go ahead, sir.
Should I?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
IDSP.
Continue, sir. Hello.
IDSP type of setting is very good. And in fact, we are making at national level in coordination, IVRI has also roped in and made an inventory of who are the experts in these diseases, what are the labs that are working on these important pathogens, genetic pathogens, and what are the tests available with them. That is the inventory of human resource, competent human resource. So once that inventory is available to everybody, once one suspects that it may be a zoonotic disease, a new zoonotic disease, then definitely using that kind of repertory, a knowledge base, one can straight away communicate with them and can send the samples to them. Second thing is the surveillance. Surveillance for that IDSP is excellent. This kind of surveillance is also needed. This kind of surveillance is also needed, actually, in the veterinary settings. So that all the data, not only from government organization, but actually there is a need, just like CDC and Public Health Laboratory Services, Colindale, UK, that wherever there is a disease, and it is recognized by human physician, animal, these veterinary physicians or wildlife expert, it is reported to that command center. And immediately, they send, if there is a need, a expert team to see that why it has happened. But who is reporting? It is the ground report. It is the people who are working in the ground setting, in wild setting and all that. And that is how the samples are picked up, and or they are instructed to send the samples in a proper way so that it can be analyzed. Many a times we receive the samples in a very shabby conditions, so we can't process them for arriving at a diagnosis. But whenever there is unusual mortality in any particular species, which suspects that, although veterinarians are well aware that this is a regular type of mortality pattern or infectivity pattern in particular area, but over and above that, if somebody again endowed with that clinical curiosity thinks that it is something new, something different, then one can definitely communicate with the same. That's what I 3C I said: coordinate, communicate, and cooperate.
Yes. I've seen here in this webinar, most of the participants are students. So I want to ask, one of my students asked me that, sir, what are the different priority area for developing their future, their career in this in future for materialistic approach to serve the society? So the student was asking that, is there, what are the different priority criteria for our future careers goals, for setting their goals, that they were asking.
Actually, we all know that veterinary is such a noble stream to serve not only the animal kind, but through the animal kind to mankind. My contention here is this: what is your area of interest in which you want to work? VPH becomes important because it has got a permanent wing in the WHO, because they are considered an expert in zoonotic diseases, all kind of food safety and food-borne infections and intoxication issues, and as well as the environmental protection. We see all kind of hygiene that are dealt with here: fish hygiene, meat hygiene, milk hygiene, environmental hygiene, and all kind. So point is this: if you want to serve, you can choose the professional line as per this. But most important, wherever you are working, basically we all are veterinarians, we must appreciate. So unless we educate the people in this area in which veterinarians are more knowledgeable, how can we expect the respect from the society? If we are pursuing this three through any way, you may be a teacher, you may be a researcher, you may be serving through RVC, you may be serving to any career option over it. As such, if you call that in, you know, we don't have a kind of setup here. Now, of course, it may come and as one health center in which the veterinarians will also be posted. All the streams, medicos will also be posted. There, of course, the posts will come where you can work with other experts of other from other streams to work with this approach under one health umbrella. So this is the thing, that wherever you are a one-man army. You are a knowledge source. But question is this: whether we are teaching or we are educating or enriching, like on every important day, World Zoonosis Day, we come out with pamphlets, we spread it, we organize so many programs, we spread, distribute the pamphlets, like on World Rabies Day, and that's why they respect. We organize free rabies camps by joining with several NGOs like Rotary and other clubs. That is how we, while doing in any capacity, we can always serve the society. That I believe, whatever stream, depending upon preferences and our love for that stream within the veterinary profession, we can pursue always.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I'd like to thank you, sir, for thank you for your. You want to speak? Now it's time to have a vote of thanks. I'd like to thank our patroners in PH, Dr. S.P.S. Malik, sir, for his delivering a comprehensive and eye-opening talk on One Health. He delivered the cause of diseases, emerging diseases like biodiversity loss, role of vectors, and the cyclic cycle which is maintaining the pathogens. So it was very interesting to hear, and most of the students, they have been benefited, and the academic staff will have been benefited because of that. So I thank you very much, sir, from Hartley. Now I'd like to thank our Vice Chancellor for Dr. S.P. Tiwari, sir, for his constant guidance and for allowing to organize this informative webinar. And also thank Dr. S. Tomar, sir, our respected Dean, sir, for his overwhelming support and suggestions for and sharing his time for during the webinar. I thank the participants, which includes veterinarians, field veterinarians, academics, and mostly the students. I hope they will be benefited from this talk with the very informative knowledge and informations regarding One Health, and all they will
share with their one and all in their associations, so then you can achieve the mission that is one health and one medicine in real term. I thank special thanks to Lua Haryana for sponsoring the technical support for webinar, and also I thank one and all for who were engaged in this in organizing this webinar. So thank you very much. So over to Dr. Aditi ma'am.
So thanks again. Thanks a lot for sharing your valuable knowledge and sparing your valuable time with us to deliver such an informative and concise yet comprehensive lecture to all the participants. Thank you from the core of our
heart. Thank you very much, Dr. Aditi. Through you, I would like to profusely thank your Dean, Dr. Baghel, and your Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Spitiwari. We are friends, old-time friends. We belong to the first batch of IVRID in the university. And I'm so happy to see him on this quoted position. And it is so nice of him to call when he was already in a meeting. I wish I could have personally greeted through this seminar to him. But please convey my remembrance and regards to him.
Yes.
Special thanks to you for making it such a wonderful occasion that I could interact with my colleagues, with my students, and with my esteemed seniors. I thank the God Almighty above all for being so kind to me so that I could meet such wonderful people through this webinar. And I hope we will be meeting in the time to come as and when the profession demands. And it is always a welcome to interact with you all. I really enjoyed making thoroughly my presentations, and I hope it really serves the purpose for which I made with all sincerity. Thank you very much.
So it's an honor to all of us to hear to you. And we apologize, sir. Actually, our Honorable Vice Chancellor had a video conferencing with the Honorable Governor today.
I could not make it today. I know. He has called in between. He was in the meeting, important.
Okay,
and that's why I am especially obliged to him. I mean, it is always a pleasure to meet and greet the friend. And we are all-time friends. Please convey my special thanks and regards to him. I'll be speaking to him in private capacity. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks.
Okay. Bye.